Hello and welcome to Café DC. I'm Faiz Rehman. We are honored to have a very special guest with us today, Mr. Grover Norquist, a legendary figure in American politics, especially here in Washington. And we'll talk to him about his group ATR, which is Americans for Tax Reforms, and other political issues. Welcome, sir. Thank you very much. Like I said, it's an honor to have you here. So let's start with this pledge, something which really made you, as they say, the most powerful Republican in this country. Do you agree? If not, why? And what is this pledge?
Well, the Taxpayer Protection Pledge is a written commitment that I share with candidates. And if they wish, they can sign the pledge. The pledge is to the American people. It's not to me. It's not to Americans for Tax Reform, my taxpayer group. It's to the American people. It's a pledge. If elected, a candidate says, I will vote against and oppose any effort to raise taxes. Tax reform, fine. Tax increases, no. Today, there are 219 members of the U.S. House who've made that commitment, about 43 U.S. senators. So we have most Republicans take the pledge, enough to stop any tax increase. And when you have had a Republican control of the House or the Senate or the presidency, we've stopped any tax increase from getting through in Washington, D.C. The tax issue is the most powerful issue in American politics. And the pledge is the clearest way to explain your position on taxes.
So there are like about 1,000 different politicians, elected officials across the country who have signed up on this pledge.
Yes.
And basically, and looking at the last major elections, like in 2012, some of them were feeling remorse that why did we, quote unquote, why did they sign? Because, you know, this kind of stopped them from doing what they had to do to make this organization or this institution run, especially the Congress. So why do you think they don't have a chance to go back on their pledge? Are you ready to relinquish them, like, you know, release them? Maybe just, you know, okay, you're no longer bound by this pledge.
The pledge, again, is not to me, it's to the American people. Any congressman or senator could say, I lied to you in order to get power. I am now going to raise your taxes.
Those are strong words. I mean, they're not going to say it.
Well, but they could if they wanted to. They could say, I wasn't planning to raise your taxes. I've changed my mind. My word to you is not important. Lying to you is not important. But vote for me anyway. People tend not to do that because they won the election because they made a commitment to voters that voters expected would be kept. George Herbert Walker Bush, Bush 41, president from 1988 to 92, had a very successful presidency. He managed the collapse of the Soviet Union without a lot of blood on the floor. He kicked Saddam Hussein and the Iraqi army out of Kuwait and didn't get stuck occupying Iraq for 10, 12 years. He had a very good foreign policy, a very successful presidency, except he promised he wouldn't raise taxes. He broke his word.
He said, read my lips during the that was his famous.
But he also signed the pledge. Mm-hmm. Word for word, he signed the pledge. And he said on TV, read my lips, no new taxes. He lied his way into office. When that became clear, he was rejected in 92. The American people have made it very clear, if you get elected on a promise not to raise taxes, they will be very unhappy if you break that promise. So people don't, some people want to raise taxes. They don't sign the pledge. Some people know in their hearts, I'm never going to vote for a tax increase. It's easy for them to take the pledge. If you don't know, don't sign the pledge. We don't want maybes. We only want people who are clearly not going to raise taxes. And so it's been a very powerful tool for the American people to keep control of their elected officials.
So it's a proverbial rock and a hard place once they sign it. That's what they get themselves into, right? I mean, they can't face you or the American public.
Well, here's the challenge. There's never a reason to raise taxes. The government's spending too much money. We don't have a problem in America because the government doesn't take enough money by force from the American people. We have a problem because the government spends and wastes too much money. The reason why the pledge was very much in the newspapers over the last 2 to 3 years was that Barack Obama had spent so much money that he was running up against the debt ceiling. There's a legal ceiling to how much money the government can borrow. And he had to get Congress to pass a law to let him pass the debt ceiling, to raise the debt ceiling. And Congress said, we'll vote for that if you cut spending $2.5 trillion over the next 10 years. He wanted $2.5 trillion and more in debt. We said, you gotta have $2.5 trillion in reduced spending, not tomorrow, but over the next decade. He wanted to have tax increases instead of spending restraint. And the Republicans in Congress said, no, all spending restraint, no taxes. And he kept coming back a dozen times. What about this tax increase? What about this tax increase? No, no, no tax increases. And eventually we won. Some in the establishment, the liberals, the left in America, people who support the Democrats, were desperately trying to get the Republicans to agree to a tax increase to give the president cover. They said no.
But Grover, I understand, I mean, you are a conservative and you are a Republican, and of course they're for no taxes, it's fine. But when you say you are for no tax, I mean, no increase in no tax increase, but reforms are okay. So inherent in that argument is basically, yes, you can reduce the taxes, you can cut the spending here and there. Even the spending is kind of, you know, there is this very selective curse that the Republicans propose. For example, the military is the huge area where most of the dollars go. But according to the conventional wisdom and what you hear in Congress, they're not for any cuts in the military's budget. So why it seems that it's selective, and why you're just giving them two options, either decrease or no decrease, but there can't be any slightest increase in the taxes.
Correct. No tax increase. That's off the table for people who take the pledge. The reason for that is that the pressures of government and the corruption of government are always trying to get people to go steal more money from the American people and give it to their friends. And you have to have a very emphatic no, because the people who want more money will always come back and say, oh, no, no, go steal more money from the taxpayers and give it to me and my friends. And they're very loud and they're very active. So you have to have an elected party, a group of congressmen and senators who in their hearts have decided we're not raising taxes, not now, not ever, off the table, completely. Now, how do we reduce spending? You'd mentioned that defense spending, military spending.
Selective, areas that you have in mind.
But it's not. Defense spending is about 20% of the U.S. budget. 80% is something other than national defense. We spend more money on health care. We spend a lot more money, federal, state, and local, on education than we do on national defense. There are a lot of things the federal government and state and local governments do. Defense is about 4% of GDP. Mm-hmm. The government's about 30% of GDP. Mm-hmm. Defense is a very small part of the total budget. Now, it's more than most other countries, mm-hmm. because the United States has a big
right.
economy. But it's a very small part of the United States budget. And of
20% is still
20% of the federal budget, 4% of the economy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and most European countries are maybe about 2%, but I don't even know why some of them have armies, because they don't ever do anything with them, except ask us to go save them whenever they get in trouble. But so we had a cut, the sequester, which is the law. It is a limit on how much the government can spend on domestic discretionary spending. Half of that is defense, half of that is non-defense. This excludes entitlements like health care and Social Security and retirement, just the sort of discretion, what we call discretionary spending in the United States. So that, half of it's a cut in defense spending, half of it's domestic discretionary. So we very much put a limit on military spending as a result of our effort to keep total government spending down.
Well, we have to take a short break here, but
sure.
when we come back, we're going to talk to you about, is it true that you, Grover Norquist, is helping cause gridlock in Congress and shutdowns? So after we come back, please stay with us.
No Republican in the House voted for the stimulus, the stupid waste a bunch of money, $800 billion money for our corrupt friends bill.
Welcome back. Okay, so when we left for the break, we were talking about this gridlock and shutdowns, and especially in Washington, the federal government. What is undisputed in Washington is, yes, there is a gridlock in Congress, and Congress is not working. And some believe that you and your group, ATR, has been one of the factors, or probably the factor, because then there's a very strong conviction on the Republican side that no taxes, and then, of course, the Democrats believe that without raising taxes, they cannot do anything practically. So where do they meet? I mean, what happens to compromise? What happens to the interest of the common man in this street?
The interest of the common man, the interest of the American people, is to have a strong and growing economy, to have a safe government, a safe country, and a competent government. And all of those things start with don't raise taxes. Because if you raise taxes, the government will take the money and waste it. If you raise taxes, the American people have less freedom. If the government takes more of your life in taxes, you have less of your life. Every hour you work that the government takes the money you earn is an hour.
But you can get more in some other ways. I mean, you can get better roads, you can get better bridges, you can get some better amenities in your localities.
That's not what they do with the money. We have a gasoline tax that's supposed to build roads. They take that money and they give it to light rail in cities. They build bike paths. They don't build roads. They lie. They say, we're going to build roads with this gas tax. And then they spend the money other places. Then they come back and say, give us more money for roads. So politicians and government spend a lot of time lying to the people, saying, if you give me money, I'll spend it on this. No, they won't. They'll spend it on their friends. They'll spend it on other things. They don't spend it on what people want. So giving them more money is always a mistake. They don't spend it on what people want. They say, if you gave me more money, I might spend it on roads. Well, for the last 50 years, you didn't. You kept siphoning it off and spent it on other things. It's not crumbling, but it's not doing as well as it could. And a lot of the money we spent, thought we were spending on roads, went to the government. They spent it on other issues. Now, when politicians and people of the left say, oh, we have gridlock in Washington, Washington doesn't work, what they mean is Washington, the old Washington, for 50 years, every year, the government would get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. Nixon, the Republican, wanted the government to be bigger. And Teddy Kennedy, the liberal Democrat, wanted to be much bigger. And they would compromise somewhere between bigger and much bigger, somewhat bigger. But we were always moving towards bigger government. We now, thanks to Ronald Reagan's leadership, have two political parties. One says smaller, one says bigger government.
But Reagan did raise taxes.
Well, Reagan wasn't in power. He was just the president. He didn't have control of the Congress. When the Republicans had control of the Congress and the presidency, they stopped tax increases cold. And he largely cut taxes, but it's true. He was forced in some cases because many of the Republicans back then weren't worth anything. They weren't really Reagan Republicans. They were just nominally Republicans. And they were for tax increases too. They are dead or retired or moved on. The new generation.
And one of them is Senator Simpson. Sorry for the interruption.
He's retired. He's not in power anymore. Bob Dole, other Republicans who were cheerleaders for higher taxes. That's the old Republican Party. That's gone. The modern Republican Party,
those
the Reagan
were around
Republican
in the Reagan administration, you know.
Yeah.
Event, so
no. Reagan came in. He was he changed the modern Republican Party. But when he showed up in Washington, many congressmen and senators had gotten their worldview 20, 30, 40 years earlier, and they thought it was inevitable for the government to grow. There are new rules in Washington. One party wants a smaller government. One party wants a bigger government. There's not a compromise. One will win and one will lose. And ever since the Republicans captured the House, the Republicans have won. And the president has lost. The president wanted trillions of dollars in higher taxes and more spending. And the Republican House said, no, that's not gridlock, that's winning. The president wanted more spending, we said no. The president wanted higher taxes, we said no. We forced the president, beat him, the American people forced the president to sign a bill making 85% of George W. Bush's tax cuts permanent. They were only temporary. Every couple of years they were going to disappear.
And he got a lot of like flack for that. Like,
from the left. Yeah.
Well, you know, when you say left and right, I don't think American politics is so stark. You know, so like, you know,
the left there are wants blue dogs. Bigger government.
There
no,
are blue
aren't.
Dogs.
There, Name I mean, two. There's I mean, no such
in,
thing.
In the Democratic Party. I mean,
every single Democrat voted for Obamacare. Every single Democrat in the Senate voted to create
a
monstrous...
And a few Republicans as well.
No, no Republican voted for Obamacare. Not one. No Republican in the House voted for the stimulus, the stupid waste a bunch of money, $800 billion money for our corrupt friends bill, okay? Mm-hmm. Every single Republican voted against it. There was a Republican, the senator voted for it. He had to switch parties and become a Democrat. Arlen Specter. Mm-hmm. The two parties are very much different. When you talk about blue dogs, that's 20 or 30 years old. There are some Democrats who pretend to be blue dogs. Well, I'm a blue dog, meaning I'm a conservative Democrat. Yeah. But they vote with Obama when their vote is needed. Mm-hmm. They are retiring, they are dying, or they're being defeated. There aren't two in Congress. I can't think of one, but I give myself some some leeway if I say there aren't two. Yeah. I don't think there are any. There's no Democrat who consistently votes as a limited government advocate in the entire House or Senate. They've either died, been defeated in office, or switched parties and become Republicans. Two parties are not on all issues. Many Democrats support the Second Amendment, the right of people to keep and bear arms. Almost all Republicans do, but many Democrats do. But on spending and tax issues, no. The Democrats are on one side, the Republicans are the other, and that's why it's such an important issue. We have stopped the president, since the Republicans captured the House in 2010, from any new spending initiatives. Mm-hmm. We beat him and made him cut taxes dramatically, one of the largest tax cuts in modern American history. That's not gridlock, that's winning. The left says...
One group is winning. I mean, you know, do you think...
Republicans
are
winning.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, so do you think it's a good idea for the American people
yes.
to have just one group win all the time, and others, I mean, who are also in a great number. I mean, you can't... I mean, this is not just a Republican country. Yeah. I mean, you know, it's almost like a split. So, I mean, if one group wins and or claims to win all the time, what happens to the other great...
Well, if you have a good idea, you go to the American people. A majority of Americans don't want higher taxes. A majority of Democrats don't want higher taxes. The politicians in the Democratic Party owe their political power to labor unions and trial lawyers and special spending interests, not to the people who vote for them. They don't, you know, they get all the votes of African Americans. They don't do anything for them. They just take their votes and then ignore them. The special interests and the powerful people that the Democrats
obviously
back.
Democrats will have something else to say to this.
They do, but they're wrong.
Let me put
otherwise
this...
explain how poorly they've treated the African American community in cities. They treat them very poorly.
Let me put this into a context, since this program is viewed largely overseas. There are countries outside this country where people just don't pay any taxes or very minimum. And they aren't very strong or powerful or influential country in this world. I mean, they just, you know, they live, but the people are poor because, you know, there isn't enough money to go around. Yeah. Do you think that's, I mean, that's like an ultimate goal of your group, right? Just don't pay taxes.
Name a country. You've got countries. Pakistan, India, they have many taxes. People avoid them. The taxes are hidden. They have massive regulations. Neither Pakistan or India have anything that looks like a free economy. The United States is rich because we had a free economy for many, many years. When we were founded and we threw the British out, we were paying between 1 and 2% of our income in taxes, 1 to 2%. We became powerful and big and grew because we had an open immigration policy and millions and tens of millions of people came. And two, we had very low taxes. When people come to your country and bring talent and opportunity to your country, and when they're allowed to become, to do anything they want in life, whether they want to be artists or rich people or businessmen or anything they want to do, that's what creates wealth. Government just sucks it off. Government doesn't create wealth. Government doesn't create anything. Government can take money from people and build the pyramids.
Well, through some, like, you know, bailouts, do you think they help create some wealth? You know,
no. They build
out some very, you know, strong, very powerful companies, and in the end, they created, like, you know, they got a lot of money back with some interest.
They threw money into GM.
And then,
General Motors should have gone bankrupt.
Got out, and then, really?
Yes. Well, because it doesn't, a company that goes bankrupt doesn't disappear. Mm-hmm. Many companies go bankrupt. They restructure. And the reason they threw the money in was the president wanted to pay off friends of his. A lot of the money that was paid out to organize labor, to the labor union bosses, those companies should have gone bankrupt.
You mean his base, like those
his political friends,
voted for him.
And direct friends, people who are actively involved in General Motors, yeah.
One important question I need to get out of the way before we get into another topic. In 2012, a lot was written about you and your group because America was going to re-elect Barack Obama, mm-hmm. The election, and of course Senate and also Congress election. Now 2014, no presidential election, but a lot is at stake because if the Republicans win a majority in the Senate, they already have a majority in Congress,
right.
And it will be, do you think that will contribute to more quote-unquote gridlock, or the Republicans will win and the president will just give in?
Sure.
So what's going to happen, and how you see it, and why we don't see that much of a noise about you and your group in this election cycle?
Because we won. They were hoping to defeat us in 2011, 2012, and get a tax increase passed. They failed. We beat them. We got the sequester on spending. We made the Bush tax cuts permanent. The Obama and the Democrats lost. We beat them. So they don't complain about us anymore because we won. They're not trying to raise taxes. They can't get the more spending they want. So there's no point in whining if you lost. We now have a situation where the Republican House, if there's a Republican Senate, which is likely, not guaranteed, but possible, mm-hmm. and more likely than not.
The Washington Post is actually also, their prediction is that 52 probably Republicans and...
That sounds about right.
Yep.
A Republican House and Senate together can pass legislation to Obama. Right now, the Republican House can't make the president sign something or veto it. You could pass a lot of bills that had little things that the president would prefer not to sign, but it's not that big a deal, so he might. Mm-hmm. So I think you'll have a lot of little steps forward towards better, less corrupt government because we get Republican control of the House and Senate. And then it'll be clear if the president is vetoing popular bills just how left-wing he is. Right now he can stand there, I haven't vetoed anything, because mm-hmm. the Senate kills the legislation. Mm-hmm. He didn't have to veto. Republican House and Senate, he'll have to veto. He'll have to say yes, no to a lot of issues. And as Clinton did, and that's why we could elect a Republican president after Clinton, because he had forced himself his hand, and he was so obviously against policies that the American people wanted. He twice vetoed the reform of welfare, which was one of the most popular things he ever did. He signed it the third time because the Republicans kept coming back and sticking it in his face. So he did sign it. Now he runs around bragging as if it was his idea. That's okay.
Okay, if you have majority in the Senate and majority in the House, yes, two branches, or one branch actually, but do you think your policies and your activism, your advocacy is mm-hmm. contributing to the unelectability of a Republican president in the future? That's what's been said out there, that they're in a nationwide campaign, the Republicans have a very little chance of electing anytime soon a Republican.
No, I think the Republicans will elect a president. The challenge for a Republican running nationally is that the Republican Party needs to be more clearly pro-immigrant in its approach and its tone and its tenor. I'm a very strong supporter of Ronald Reagan's big tent, Ronald Reagan's pro-immigration policies. There are some Republicans who I think are insufficiently understanding that immigration and strong immigration is what made America a great and powerful and important and cohesive country. And so some people use rhetoric that loses you votes. But standing up against tax increases and for limited spending elects governors and state legislators and congressmen and senators and will elect a president. But we do also have to point out that Obama has tried massively to increase taxes and spending, not something we pointed out as strongly as we should have in 2008 and 2012.
So on Ted Cruz, Senator Ted Cruz, you support him 50%, that is on no tax increase, but you oppose him on his immigration views? Is it a fair statement?
Yeah, I think Ted Cruz is from Texas and has said things that are unhelpful in terms of immigration. But he's not a particularly important player on the Republican Party on the immigration issue. The other leaders, the faith communities, all the religious groups in the United States are strongly for immigration reform. The Roman Catholics, the Protestants, the Evangelicals, the Mormons, all of these groups are very strongly supportive of immigration reform. Southern Baptists. At some point, Ted Cruz left to realize that Texas is full of Southern Baptists. But also the other challenge is Ted Cruz got involved in shutting down the government as a tactic. It was the wrong tactic. The idea of getting rid of Obamacare is a good idea, and we will do it. But the tactic was wrong, and so we kind of tripped up.
Grover Norquist, it's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good to be with you.
Absolutely.